This entitled mother doesn't understand technology at all, and she uses her ignorance as a means to accuse this innocent student of hacking into the school library. Happy birthday, today's your birthday, and on with the revamped show. There is a family that moved in a few houses down from where mine lives that has very young children, two boys and a girl, all under the age of 10, and it takes about 5 seconds of interacting with these kids to realize that they have never been told no in their entire lives. We have a tree swing out front that my parents had put in for my sister when they were little. These kids treat that swing as if it's public property. They're on it literally all the time. It drives one of my dogs absolutely crazy, as she is very protective of the house and the people inside, and barks non-stop at them when they're there. Any attempts to get the kids off the lawn results in either raspberries being blown or a temporary retreat, only to come back 5 minutes later. My mom has tried talking to the parents about this, but the most she's gotten is a shrug and a, eh, they're just kids having fun. The thing that really ticks me off though is the fact that because these brats just do whatever they want, we can't walk my dog anymore. I have two dogs. One of them is a bull mastiff puppy named Ted's, and the other is a nearly 9-year-old pit bull named Clover. Now, Clover is one of the sweetest dogs you'll ever meet. She's super gentle, loves everyone, except the mailman, and is an overall angel. She used to love going out for walks around the block, sniffing things and saying hi to everyone she met. She can't do that anymore. A couple days ago, my sister and I had Clover out for a routine walk around the block. All was fine and dandy, until one of these three hellions rolled up. It was one of the boys. I think he's about 7, and without even asking, he starts petting Clover. This initially wasn't a problem, because again, she's incredibly friendly. She sniffed at him, tail wagging, and as dogs do, licked his hand. The kid went, ew, and smacked her on the face. It startled her, clearly, but didn't put her off too much because she was still wagging. My sister and I, on the other hand, chastised him. We told him he wasn't supposed to do that, and that if he couldn't play nice, he wouldn't be allowed to pet her. Kid acted like he hadn't heard a word. Strike two came when he pulled, very harshly, on her tail. Clover yelped and backed away from him. I was about ready to dropkick him. I told him that was it. He needed to stop, and my sister and I started to walk away. This brat chased after us, whining that he wasn't done petting the doggy. We told him yes, he was done, to which he pulled out the age-old, "You can't tell me what to do." I tried explaining to this kid. Really, I did. I handed my sister the leash and had her walk Clover back home while I tried to explain to this kid that if a dog owner says no, you can't pet their dog, then you can't pet their freaking dog. "But I want to pet her." "You can't right now. Pulling on her tail hurts her. And you can't play with someone if you hurt them." "But I want to." "Maybe some other time if you're going to be more gentle, but not now." Little brat pushed past me and darted after my sister. By the time I realized what he was doing and started to chase after him, he was already right up on them. Clover was, understandably, frightened at the sight of this thing bolting straight at her. It didn't help that the first thing he did upon getting to her was grab one of her ears and pull, screeching, "Doggy!" like a kid half his age. Clover yipped very loudly and yanked away from him. Now would probably be a good time to mention that this dog has teeth the size of saber-toothed tigers. She didn't growl at him or anything, but given that he was right on her face this time, he saw those teeth very clearly when she yipped. Kid shrieks and falls over, acting as if she just tried to maul him. And my sister and I take that chance to run back home, a very frazzled Clover in tow. We explained to our mum what had happened, then braced for the oncoming storm. Sure enough, not 10 minutes later, we get a phone call. Mum picks it up to hear the dulcet tones of our neighbour screeching into the phone about how our demon dog has attacked her son, and how she was going to call animal control to get her put down. My sister and I were terrified because we knew it didn't matter whether or not Clover was innocent. She's a pit bull. People want to put pit bulls down pretty much just for existing. So any excuse, no matter how fabricated, is enough for them to do it. The two of us were practically sobbing, clinging to that sweet girl for fear that they may be our last few minutes with her. My mum managed to talk this woman down. I think the fact that we have footage of her children trespassing, as well as footage of them taking stuff from our garage, we set up a camera after we noticed like the third lawn toy mysteriously go missing, may have been mentioned, because this lady suddenly decided that perhaps calling the cops was not in her best interest. She backed off, but the damage was done. We've just been letting Clover into our fenced backyard to go to the bathroom. We haven't had her out for any walks since then, and the general consensus is that we're pretty much just going to have to keep it that way. We can't risk one of these stupid kids interacting with Clover again, because A, they're probably going to get hurt, and B, anything she does in response to that could be twisted into her being aggressive. And then, that's it. Currently, we're at something of a stalemate. The neighbor knows that if she tries to do anything to Clover, her kids get in trouble, but we know that if we do anything to hold her kids accountable, she'll do her absolute best to get Clover put down, and with the pit bull, it isn't hard. Yeah, there's nothing quite like mutually assured destruction to create peace in a neighborhood. I mean, it works for neighbors with nuclear weapons, right? So why not with entitled parents? Except an entitled parent is more like North Korea, and we're like, yeah, we don't really want them to have nukes. For one of my assignments in my coding class, we had to use a coding language, not Java, Python, or C++, to make a program and make a shorter presentation on the language, and I was stuck in VB, Visual Basic. I wasn't thrilled at first, but I came to enjoy it. Very easy. I kind of look like the stereotypical hacker from movies. Expensive laptop, white, dark hoodie, and long lines of code, and all of a sudden, poof, Karen is behind me. And so, it begins.
What are you doing?
Oh, slightly startled. I'm just...
You're hacking?
What?
Don't try to deny it. I saw the programs and lines of text. Trying to take my passwords, are you?
This is my assignment.
Oh, so someone's paying you to do this. Let me guess, trying to get out credit card numbers and email passwords.
I was confused as, what the frick are you talking about? I'm doing this for my class. I don't know if she heard me.
Hear that, everyone? This boy is trying to hack into your devices.
Ma'am, this is my school assignment.
Then why so shady? You have a black hoodie with the hood. You're up sitting alone, and there is pop-ups on your computer. Probably another account you hacked into.
First of all, I like this hoodie. Second, this spot was open, so I sat here. And third, these are error messages from my program.
Mom, what the heck is going on?
Stay out of this, PK, and don't use your phone. This criminal is trying to take money from us.
At this point, the old man, who was at the reception, walked up to the EM.
Hey miss, can you not be yelling at this kid? He's trying to get some work done, and you're just complaining in his ear. I'm deaf in this ear, and I can still hear you. Now check out a book or get lost.
That's it, let's go, PK. We're leaving, and I'm calling the police on you for hacking, and you for assault.
The old man was about 3 feet from the EM. I think you'd be surprised how many people, particularly older people, don't really understand programmers or IT in general. So if they see someone coding, the only thing they can associate it with is hacking. So, like I said, I work in daycare, and it's been a really great job as I have been working through my degree plan. I'm going into my last semester, and this is my last summer I'll be working at this company. I've never worked with a younger grade before, and they placed me with first grade for the summer. I was bummed, but it's whatever. I'm making money. So Eugene, the kid, it's a fake name, is in my group of students. He was a pretty good kid. Didn't have to talk to him much because he was always reading. Well, his name on my sheet of kids was listed as Eugene last name, so for the entirety of the first half of the summer, that's what I called him. That's what he introduced himself as. That's what the other kids called him. One day I was leaving at the same time that Eugene was leaving, and I saw him leaving with his mum. He saw me and said, "Bye, mister." And I said, "Bye, Eugene. I'll see you tomorrow." His mum flipped around so fast, I thought she was going to get whiplash.
"Do not call my son that."
I was taken aback. I didn't even know what to say at that point. It was his name and what I had called him all summer. So I just nodded and the kid said,
"She only lets people call me Julian."
Fake name. So I let the mom know I would do my best to call him Julian and would make note of it. After this encounter, the kid was starting to really misbehave. I remembered to call him Julian and that was something that he seemed to respond okay to, but he still wouldn't listen. Well, one day he was climbing on something and he almost fell. So I came up behind him to try and catch him. He swung up at me and I moved back and said, "Eugene, stop." I corrected myself immediately and he looked at me and I kid you not.
"Mommy said I don't have to listen to you when you call me that."
So basically I just called for a manager. When they came, I explained everything and told her about the name. She corrected it on the roster, but I was surprised the kid tried to hit me. So I called him by the name I learned first out of impulse. He got in trouble and the mum was ticked. She called the facility and said I was bullying her son. Even even though I had literally only slipped up with his name once. She stood in the office for, I kid you not, 2 hours, demanding that I get fired. Basically, they told her to go away, and if she has an issue with the name, that she should have just listed him as Julian. It's not uncommon for people to have preferred nicknames, but usually they're shorter names of the actual name, not an entirely different name. If you want your kid to be called a different name, that's fine. You just have to not expect everyone to just magically know that that's what they're supposed to call them. Write it down in the first place, or just let them know that they have a preferred name. Hi Voicy, I never really post in any subreddits, but I figured that dealing with my first ever entitled parent was special enough to share. For some context, I work at my city's zoo. It's nothing special. I'm just a part-time cashier, and while I have several positions throughout the park, selling animal food or ride tickets, I spend most shifts working in the box office selling admission tickets. During the summer, we host a special event on weekends where guests can buy tickets and come to the zoo after closing, and we have all kinds of food, performances, music playing, and lantern displays set up around a specific path that encompasses about half of the park. It's important to note that people can buy memberships to our zoo for a one-time fee, and that membership will get them into the zoo at no extra cost for one calendar year. It's more expensive than general admission, but for frequent visitors, it pays for itself after just a few visits. But the memberships don't cover admission for the lantern event because we don't run it. We're just a location for the company to use, since normally we close in the early evening anyway. If someone buys tickets pre-sale, they can save a little money, and members can save a little more than that. But if you show up after a certain time on the day of the event to get tickets, you're subject to our more expensive day of pricing, where none of our usual discounts apply, and everyone, adults, children, and seniors, are all the same price. On with the story. I'd been working a double shift in the box office when this happened, which I just thought I should mention so you get an idea of how little patience for shenanigans I had left. It's easier to keep cashiers for 10 to 14 hours than schedule more people for shorter shifts. The day hasn't been bad so far, especially for a Sunday, and we weren't really expecting a huge turnout for the lantern event, since there was a chance of storms that night. Lanterns go from 6:30 to 10:30, and attendance ranges from 1,000 to 5,000 plus, going up to 8,000 on the busiest nights. Crowds had shown up, but were manageable until this EM showed up at my window. I had my guard down since she didn't look like a Karen, and didn't have any kids in tow. Turns out, they were waiting over by the entrance. But boy was I wrong. The conversation went approximately as follows.
Hi, I need tickets for the lantern event tonight. I have 2 adults and 4 kids with me.
Okay, that'll be the admission price for 6 people, over $100.
What? How much are the kids' tickets?
Everyone is under the same price tonight since we moved into day of pricing. I gesture to the sign in my window with the prices and policies clearly displayed.
That's absurd. Why are they so expensive? My kids probably won't even make it through the whole thing.
I'm sorry, ma'am. We don't set the prices. I hear this complaint a lot, and most of the time I can defuse the situation, or the guest just sucks it up and deals with the cost or heads back home instead.
Don't you have any kind of discount?
The only discounts we offer are for pre-sale. Those prices are the cheaper price for the public, and even cheaper price for our zoo members.
I'm a zoo member!
She whips out her membership card and throws it through the slot in my window. I'm sorry, ma'am, this only works if you buy tickets before the day of the actual event. I slide the card back. She starts going off about how ridiculous everything is, when, lucky me, she hears the girl next to me sells tickets to her guest at the discounted member price. Our website is terrible to navigate, so sometimes when people have trouble buying pre-sale tickets, or their card doesn't go through, they'll call our office and cash handling will put together a list of people who called and can buy tickets at the pre-sale price on the day of the event and bring it to the box office that evening. Those people will come up, tell us that they called and who they talked to, their name with an ID, and verify how many tickets they were trying to buy. Sometimes people will come up and say that they tried to do it online but didn't call, and if they're polite, I'm happy to give them the discount anyway. And the managers don't care, since they have a ton of other stuff to deal with in the park.
Why did she get the discounted price?
I explain our system.
Well, I called too, and I should be on the list.
I'm not buying it, but I humor her. Okay, ma'am, you just need your name and ID. She pauses for a second. I assume she was reconsidering the move she was about to make, but she gives me both, and obviously she's not on the list. I'm sorry,
but you're not listed on here, so I can't give you the discount. I could've, but she was being so rude that I didn't want to let her have it.
This is so freaking stupid! All of this!
I'm sorry, ma'am, there's nothing I can do.
You know what? I should get my tickets for free.
Pardon me?
For all the trouble you're causing me, and all the money I paid for this membership, I should get free tickets!
Literally nobody gets free tickets except some employees. We don't even give refunds unless you have some kind of extreme circumstance. I can't do that, ma'am.
Then I want to speak to your manager if you're going to be useless.
Being familiar with stories of entitled parents and their perceived finishing moves, this is what I had been anticipating. As luck would have it, all our managers were off doing something else in the park, and the only way to contact them was over the radios. So that's what I did. Me on the radio. Can I get a manager to the box office, please? It'll be about 20 minutes. We have a situation we're dealing with. Turns out a crowded outdoor event in 100 degree weather is a perfect recipe for lots of people getting heat exhaustion. So I relay this information to EM. She went off to tell her husband and kids, and I guess they didn't want to wait that long, because she came back, threw her card through my window slot, and paid the admission price. But not without grumbling under her breath the entire time, and telling me all about how she's going to call and get me fired, and that she's never coming back here again, despite that expensive membership. Another family came up a little later and mentioned how they tried to order online, but it didn't work. They weren't on the list, but they had been nothing but polite the entire time. So I didn't hesitate to give them the pre-sale member price for their whole family.
Submit your story to be read on the channel at voiceyhearstories@gmail.com and join our Voicey veteran community at r/voiceyhere. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode. All right, Voicey veterans, I'll see you in the next one.